stated civil and human rights, and even according to their own ethics, violated law enforcement codes of ethics. People need to understand that that's true, those are facts, and if they ever allow us, for example, in the case of Leonard Peltier, very soon, we hope to prove that. We hope to prove to people that, that the government, the FBI, and local levels of police agencies do commit crimes, do violate the law, and many times convict people unjustly and illegally.
We had a two-part series on the Greensboro, North Carolina murders of the labor organizers, where it was revealed that the FBI and the local police, et cetera, actually instigated the violence, actually infiltrated these different groups and themselves began the violence. Isn't there a parallel here to the Peltier case and the Wounded Knee case, where it's not that the Indians instigated the violence, but rather the FBI themselves began that? Do you have some information?
Well, yes, we do. And the most glaring example that we have, of course, is Douglas Durham, who infiltrated the American Indian Movement. And we have part of the Amnesty International report regarding the American Indian Movement and the FBI. And I was just reading here whereby documented already is Douglas Durham's case. Douglas Durham got to be in leadership, or got next to the leadership of the American Indian Movement. Today, Douglas Durham, after he was uncovered as an informant of the FBI, is today a very not wealthy, but very comfortable person who travels on the college circuit, and also paid by the John Birch Society to discredit groups that are active, action groups, social action, political activist groups, progressive organizations, to discredit their work. And he's now supported and financed by the John Birch Society, and we understand that connection too with all the other agencies. So again, like you say, there's very similar
and he actually
parallels.
Instigated the violence, this Durham.
Of course,
he infiltrated the groups, and
he would find the explosives, he would find the he would come up with the clever ideas, and the same thing in Leonard.
And they knew who was traveling where, when people were going to do this and that. They just had it down pat.
What's been the reaction of the mass media and all that? You never see anything in the regular press about Leonard Peltier or what's really going on to the Native American people.
We do have some developments working with, such as contracts with 20th Century Fox to do movies on a portrayal in Leonard's life, okay, as well as to give some accounts of the oppression and the movement and what the people were fighting for.
There's a book coming out too.
We have a major novel that is now into the publisher. It's called Spirit of Crazy Horse, or either Crazy Horse Spirit, and it'll be a story on Leonard's life. And again, it'll be given actual times, dates, places, and experiences, and all the actual names of everybody is involved into the book.
And Robert Redford is the one who was primarily interested in doing a movie on it.
Yeah, he's doing a lot of his own investigations right now, really researching the movie, because right now I think our commitments are getting stronger to where he will probably want to produce and direct the movie for us. Mm-hmm. Of course, in our contracts, we're open to really anybody who we want to choose that will tell the truth in the best way it can be told on film.
What about network television? The 60 Minutes, for instance, done anything?
Well, but presently, this year's part of the work of building the awareness for Leonard is to get a lot of the American people to write letters to 60 Minutes to have them take an interest in the Peltier story, such as to Paul Lowenwater, who works within the network. Phil Donahue, we have connections into ABC Close Up. People's Magazine came out a year ago in April with an article on Leonard that was very well. New Age Magazine. So he's been in the Rolling Stones. He's been in the Village Voice. So it is picking up on a lot of levels. But keeping it in the local media right now is the responsibilities that all the support groups that are having in their areas right now. Like, you asked about international support. We have like over 40 support groups throughout the countries in Europe that have active groups going. Okay, in the United States, we have approximately 30 groups. And throughout this tour since March 8th, in which we've been on a constant public awareness campaign to support the writ, we've established at least 14 more groups to add to the national level. So, I mean, we're building very rapidly, and we're the most beautiful thing of all is to see the spirit of the people come together under serious issues such as Leonard, and standing up to see the spirit that's generated to keep us going is very strong. And really, you can only say so much because it's an invisible power that we're all looking for in reality, what unity really means, what sharing, working together really means. And I really think through the experiences, we've came a long way, because all people knew about before was that Leonard was put on a 10 most wanted list and he was a killer and people didn't want no part of it, you know? And now that we've been able to build awareness worldwide on him, it's growing to where people are becoming concerned that they're given a chance to hear the case. And that's the realities of it. And we just hope to just keep on in the manner that we're going. Our chances of Leonard winning the new trial is very positive. We don't want to think no other way. And we hope we can build a mass movement worldwide, such as we did with Angela Davis, to stop the Vietnam War, to stop the draft, because we're going to have to redo all these things again with how they got plans for people to do the draft again, you know, and they're going to be taking them. I mean, they're already messing with the old people's blood, Social Security and pension checks that they're getting. And with the high prices of all the energies going up, you know, that we need for our lifestyles, I mean, people need to organize. They need to get together. And right now, I think one of the most important elements of life that people need to start learning is not just look at nature as a coincidence and things happen naturally, but we have to start understanding on how we are a part of that survival, and we have to start learning to respect and use those things together in the best way possible instead of putting prices on them and forget about the people if they couldn't follow this understanding of the policy and the education on how you take care of your needs. Then they don't have no way of surviving. Then what do? They steal, they become alcoholics, and they just wind up committing suicide. They send them to institutions. I mean, we have a sick society because people's got problems. And we set up different little programs, and now all those programs that are dealing with people's lives are being threatened through Reagan's madness or the nuclear energy. All the nuclear warheads going into Europe, you know, is really incredible, because right now they have enough to blow up the world. And if we allow the government to blow up the world, I mean, we're gone as people. The generations are no more. I mean, the Earth will survive itself in time. You know, it'll be thousands of years before it'll regather its strength in order to have its natural strength again, you know. But what's going to happen to the people if we allow the uranium thing to go on? And I think examples such as are coming out of a lot of different nuclear alliance groups, such as the one in Canada 2 years ago now, through testing of a mother moose, they had to find out why she gave birth to a two-headed moose. She was eating the vegetation life, and they found out from the testing that the uranium chemicals changed their hormones. And if this can happen to an animal with two heads, what can happen to people in reality, when we already know for 20 years in the community of Oglala, in the government housing that they put up, there's uranium chemicals in the wall in which people are affected by the outcome of that today. And it's just a matter of time on how it does away with each and every individual, because the creations of the great mystery is really beautiful if we can just learn to look at it and evaluate it, what it really has to offer. And living with man-made laws that put prices on our natural rights to use the land and the air and the water is incredible. You know, that's taken away from a natural born right, because our Indian people had a way of life in this land, and today we're struggling to hang on to that knowledge in order for these children to have a chance in the coming futures. Because you look at the government going into the space age is unbelievable, where we can think we're going to be space people. You know, we're Earth people, and we need the air, and we need the water, and we need the land. And we're going into unknown things that we should not tamper with, in a simple sense. We don't need to tamper with. Ever since they've been to the moon, the seasons have not been the same. It's been a big imbalance. And the Earth is losing its energies, because in our Indian beliefs, you just can't keep taking from the Earth and taking and taking and taking, using up all those energies. Around the world, energy is being used 24 hours a day from the trucks. From the time they take it from the Earth, putting it through the processes, transporting it to the people, getting it into the stores, the people going to work, getting their checks, buying these things that they need. And we look in time, where does it all go back? It goes back into the garbage that we've just polluted and contaminated. And we destroy the Earth. Simple process of understanding, but what do we do to change that? I think this is where we're at in understanding. We all got our differences, we've all got our lifestyles, our jobs that we believe in, what we're trying to learn to make a good future, but that's just for our future. that's not for the children, because they're going to be completely different also. You know, and to want, you know, a dream of what it was to live the life of my ancestor is a big hurt in many of our people that they just don't know how to express. So the only way they can express is to sacrifice the society and that is destroying us and start learning what is really your roots, your language, the traditions on how you identify foods, when you hunt, when you fish. Today you can't do that because there's nothing to fish and there's nothing to hunt. And you got to have licenses, and then when you get licensed, you still got to pay for your hunt. You know, and there's so many processes. People hunt for game, for just enjoyment. Put trophies of animals that had a spirit, they put them on the wall, locking them into zoos. You look around the world today, flying in a plane, and you look down and you see all the land is cultivated into little squares where they've got fences. Everybody owns this. And see, it just lost the energy. See, when you keep taking from the earth and you build establishments such as this, Italy gives us a good example that the time just takes care of it. It's going to, you know, we can keep rebuilding it all we want. Time is going to take care of it. But is our children going to be able to carry on those knowledges that we live by? But they're not true knowledges. They're destroying us, but yet we've all accepted it. You know, and we talk about Constitution, but the Constitution isn't it. It's natural born rights. From the time we are born, from the time we're in our mother's wombs in that water for 9 months, we come out and breathe the air, we're already exposed to all this confusion out here when before we had a simple way of what the natural law was. See, the medicine world, taking somebody else's eye, somebody else's heart, is incredible. And we weren't born to do that. We weren't born to be dope addicts and shove needles down our throats and confuse our minds with alcohol just because we can't take care of our weaknesses and we have to entertain ourselves. We had ways and medicines. Everybody had a job. Everybody had a different little job that fitted in. Not everybody was a medicine man or a buffalo hunter, or not everybody can capture the eagle, which was a medicine of wisdom and knowledge. You know, it was people like Sitting Bull, who went 100 years ago, tried to take his people into Canada because of the oppression that they were being forced on the reservation, being massacred and everything else. And they captured and brought him back into it. It's the same thing with Leonard Peltier, but only he couldn't take his people into Canada. They're struggling for the last remaining lands they have left, and it's right there at home. You know, and so this is the reality of it. I mean, we've been put on reservations. We're claiming various parts of the country, such as the Black Mesa for the Arizona, for the Navajo Hopi people. Over here for the six Iroquois nations, you got the New York State into Canada. And over here for us in South Dakota, it's the Black Hills. You know, just like it is for the people of the Northwest who are maintaining to keep the natural fish from becoming imitation fish from the enhancement through the fisheries program. On how they're claiming the fish by clipping their nose from the time they take the egg, they rear them into little processes. When the fish get about this big, they take each and every one and put a metal clip in their nose. So they go out to the natural environment for 4.5 years, come back to their natural ground, and when the fishermen catch the fish, they have to ticket it in the process. And this is how the government's claiming the fish. And they're only going to give you so much, you can't get the regular price. But see, those values there destroyed the traditional values of our people on the reservations over there, because in the old day when an Indian person was fish, his first catch would go as a ceremony and an offering to the families or the spirits. And then his catch would come for what he needs to prepare for those winter months that are coming, see. I mean, we've lost all those concepts of sharing, trading, when we all have a natural right to use the air, the water, and all the foods that come with it, see? So I think these are serious things that the uranium madness is creating a threat to, you know, and it's one of the biggest things. And then the war is about the draft. In a natural sense, we weren't born into this world to have to fight wars for people. We were born on this world to live a life of peace somehow. We need to get back to that. That's the reality of it, you know?
And so it's been since days of old when Custer died for a mountain of gold. But times have changed and passed them by. They've been replaced by the FBI. Oh, it's all so easy to weep and moan for a warfare fought so far from home. You can preach of peace from a righteous stand, but there ain't no peace on the Indian land. Joe was a lower down. The winds did blow with a mighty sound, and the answer came in the driving rain. This man shall not have died in vain. For the hollow power of the lock and key ain't nothing to the power of the raging sea. Where the lightning strikes in the angry skies, it puts the power into people's eyes. Oh, the weather is building to a mighty storm, and the words in the wind that come to warn are once more spoken to your ear. Only this time the name is Leonard Peltier. Many have gone before, and tell me how many more must be lost to the Indian Wars.
At Duck Valley Indian Reservation, a Shoshone Paiute family of a nation in protest burns in flames, dies in flames, while across the sky, the American Indian Movement burns the imperialist flag on the lower steps of the white man's house. Looking Eagle loses his wife, the wind loses Sunshine, Ricarda Star, and Eli Chasing Sun. But the wind still carries the star into the sky, and the sun is changing into the spirit of Crazy Horse. One does not sell the earth upon which the people walk. The land is still here. They did not steal it. They could not. A young one, not yet born, is lost in murderous flames as colonial agents descend upon the land with violence. It's our primary task. We will defend the land, defend the freedom of the open plains with flesh offerings on an angry body. For the indigenous family, the entire life is aflame. The veins are aflame, the heart is aflame, the eyes are aflame, the fist and the mind are aflame. One eagle feather sparks the sovereign prairie fire, and from D.C. to Duck Valley, to Wounded Knee and Ogallala, the weapons of liberation are aflame.